and welcome to another Big Country show here on Keep It Country TV. Coming up on the show this week, we'll have music from Faith Hill and her husband, Tim McGraw. We'll have something good from Roseanne Cash. We'll have some Maren Morris. We'll have one from the archives from Charlie Rich. And we'll start off the way we always do. Let's play something country. So taking us back to the year 2005 for that one, on a song that gave Brooks and Dunn their 12th country number one single. Brooks and Dunn and Play Something Country. Now, if you're a big fan of the music of Johnny Cash, then make sure you stick around for a very special interview with top Johnny Cash tribute artist JP Mack. He'll be telling us all about his Cash Returns tribute to the Man in Black a little bit later on. Before all that, it's back to the music and the current single from Maren Morris, the fourth single from her current album Hero. This one's called Rich. Maren Morris and her current single, Rich. Now it's time for something new. And a young man called Kanan Cox. He's 28. He comes from North Carolina. And he started off his music career at a very early age. He started off by playing the mandolin, the fiddle, and the guitar before going to study musical theater and then touring on the cruise ships for a few years. After that, he went to Nashville and recorded his self-titled debut EP. Here's the first single from that EP. It's called Coming Back. And here is Kanan Cox.
Yeah, I keep coming back.
Well, it's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since, well, I don't know when. I'm stuck in falls and prison, and time keeps dragging on.
And I suppose, JP, when you think about Johnny Cash, you think about that famous prison gig from the 1960s, and it must be about 50 years ago from that gig.
13th of January 1968 was the famous date. It was the album was comprised of two halves. It was like they did a morning session and they did an evening session as well. Most of the album is made up of the second part. It's a great album. Like, just hearing the warden through the tan noise and everything, you're going to get to hear a bit of the crowd in there as well. Like, it's great atmosphere. It's a good, great album.
And it was just such an iconic event, wasn't it? It was the first time anything like this had been done. It kind of grabbed the whole world, really, didn't it?
Yeah, at the time, it was just unheard of for, especially Johnny Cash. Like, he was a God-fearing kind of man, but they go into a pile of inmates and then to be seen to be giving them a good time, to give them like a concert. I think Columbia at the time as well, his record company, they were a bit miffed at it. But nobody kind of would have seen how well it was going to come across and how popular it was going to end up being. Still, even now, it's one of the top albums out there that just keeps being bought.
So do you remember the first time you became aware of the music of Johnny Cash?
Yeah, it was back home in Strabane. There's a thing called a back-to-back competition. And it was the very first time I got asked to play live music. It's part of a pub thing where pubs go off against each other. And you get to pick two songs. But before that weekend, I heard this song on the jukebox in Dicey's. And I asked Hen, the guy who worked behind the bar, I was like, what's that song? And he goes, it's Johnny Cash, Hurt. And I was like, that's brilliant. I love that sound. So back in the day, it was about 2002, 2003, we didn't have Wi-Fi in the home. So it was straight to the library, printed off the chords, printed off the lyrics. And I just went upstairs and just, and it was the first time I probably found out that I could have that similar kind of no baritone range.
Yeah.
And when I was listening, and then when I sat down with it, I didn't tell anyone because, but before then, I didn't really know anything. I think Ring of Fire probably was the height of my knowledge in Johnny Cash. So we went to rehearsals and, I threw it out. I had two other songs picked, but I asked the people I was along with to hear this. So I threw it out there, and everybody kind of looked up kind of funny. They're going, where did that come out of, you know? So that weekend then we went to the, we made it to the final at that stage, and I played that song, and it was the reaction that it got. We ended up winning, our team won that that evening. And then people said, you've got to do more of the Johnny Cash stuff. So I learned Ring of Fire after that. Had to, and after that then it was just kind of, it started to spiral. People started to hear about the Johnny Cash guy, which I'm still known as. I've lost all sense of identity now.
But it is scary because you've got the movements, because for Johnny Cash it's not just the voice, it's that unique way that he holds the guitar, isn't it?
There's a couple of things, because I'm not 6'3", I think, and I'm from Tyrone. What you got to do is, I've watched the videos, and he had a certain kind of way. He held his arm behind the guitar, and he usually would have picked it up and down and kind of used it as a gun, would have aimed down the barrel, so to speak. And then he did a lot of head tilting, especially in the 50s. But I think that might have been more to do with barbiturates and the things he was dabbling at the time, where he would have held it back. And then he had this Arkansas draw where he would have lifted it up. So wee things like that. I don't like going into too much. I like to do a point where Johnny Cash meets JP rather than going full as an impersonator. I try to be more, I use the word tribute than an impersonator, you know, because I know I'm not going to look like him. So, but if you do things like that, you do the head and you lift the guitar, people warm to it, like, you know.
I'm a highwayman, living free, running where
And of course, the ultimate thing must be when his drummer said you were great. Then he gave you this massive tribute, didn't he?
That was weird. It started with, I just recorded two songs. I recorded False in Prison Blues and I recorded Hurt with a guy from home, a guy called Peter Doherty. And I just stumbled across it. There was something came up online on Facebook or something about JohnnyCashRadio.com. It was a Tennessee-based radio station, internet station. And I looked through all the DJs, and I seen then that there was Ron Haney plus WS Holland. Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, I'll just wing them an email. Just no chance, you know. And I just told them a little bit about myself, and I sent an MP3 across. And I got an email instantly from Ron Haney, asking could I send over hard copies, picture, and just a bit of general information on myself, which I did. And I thought I was going to get maybe a wee bit of a play, and then that was it. Just it goes, here's cash returns, but what I got back was they played the two songs, and they did like an in-depth, I think it's about 12, 13 minutes.
Wow.
And then when I heard W.S. Holland say how much that sounded like the proper, like he was listening to the drums because he's a drummer, and because he just thought he wanted to see us play. And I've been talking to him in between, Ron Haney and himself, and looks like, fingers crossed, that we'll be doing something later in the year.
Oh wow. So you haven't been out to America performing yet?
I haven't been out, but there's a bit of talk going on, shall we say, and we'll hopefully, fingers crossed, if everything pans out, we can, it'll be great. Because at the end of the day, like this guy sat behind Johnny Cash for 40 odd years, and some of the biggest, like San Quentin, Folsom, some of the, I think, Madison Square Gardens as well, I think, where he filled it. Like some stories that man could tell, you know. He's the only one on the left as well, Marshall Grant, and sadly, Bob Wooten passed away as well. So he's the only guy left at the minute. So it was nice to get that feedback.
So your show, Cash Returns, is doing great business here in both North and South of Ireland, isn't it?
Yeah, it started off. It was only meant to be a one-off show. Crumlin Road Jail in Belfast here. I got an email. I didn't know about the Crum. I thought it was still a functioning prison. And I got a phone call saying, look, we've come up with this idea. We think would work really well. Obviously, the Johnny Cash and the jail thing, So nervously, I said, yes, let's do it, Then I found out that it was a visitor attraction, which kind of took a little. I was relieved, but at the same time, a little bit disappointed, shall we say. But it was December 2013, and I found out then that it sold out, and we went and played. It actually takes place in where the chapel used to be. After the December gig, we decided to do two more in the January, and the two dates they sold out. And then after that, the people that were coming. People were coming from Tyrone down Fermanagh, and then they were taking this with them, and then saying, so we ended up then starting to, the news started to get out.
Brilliant.
And it's more north based at the minute, but we've recently done a gig over in Holland. We're going back again now in August, later in the year, for a big festival. And then we're doing bits and pieces in England as well, and so we've got some gigs scheduled for down south as well. So fingers crossed, and hopefully we'll get over over the pond, over to America as well, to get a couple of gigs over there too, maybe.
Great stuff. And if there was a fully functioning prison watching this now, would you play a real prison?
There was talk. I'm not going to mention which prison, but there was. I would do it. I'd be nervous. It would probably be more of the challenge of it, because that must have took some nerve.
Yeah.
I think Cash is, he was a God-fearing man, but at the same time, there was a real dark side to him, and I think that he played up to it, and I think that's what he got.
He took a risk bringing June Carter on stage as well.
Think
those guys hadn't seen a woman for God knows how many years.
I know, I think it was mentioned in the book as well. They were expecting I think the worst they got was a bit of wolf whistle.
Yeah.
But it could have got a lot worse than that, shall we say. I think it was a brave man taking his wife out on stage. But I think she had a gift of the gab as well. She was able for them as well. If she could handle Johnny Cash, she could handle any of them boys.
And of course, your show as well. You do travel with a June Carter, don't you?
We do. Up until January, my sister actually played played June Carter. So we had to watch it. It was not very biblical, but then a little family popped up, and they need her more than we need her at the moment. So we did a bit of addition. We got a new gear in, and we auditioned from all over, but it ended up like another gear from Strabane as well, a gear called Kim Crumley, who's doing a brilliant job at the minute. Yeah, she keeps us right.
Great song from Roseanne Cash, that's called The Walking Wounded, and that's taken from a new Johnny Cash concept album called Forever Words, which features songs inspired by the lyrics, the poems, and the letters of Johnny Cash. 16 great songs on the album, and some great artists as well, including Kris Kristofferson, Willie Nelson, Casey Musgraves, Alison Krauss, Carlene Carter, Chris Cornell, and many more. So if you're a big fan of Johnny Cash, then make sure you check out the Forever Words album.
Sitting with you in a dark room.
Great song called The Rest of Our Lives from country music's most famous husband and wife team, Faith Hill and Tim McGraw. Now it's time for something new from a young lady called Stephanie Quayle. Her new album, Love the Way You See Me, is out now, and this is the brand new single. It's called Selfish. Now, for our final song on the show this week, we're going to take you back to the year 1973 in a song that gave Charlie Rich his first country number one single and also gave him a Grammy Award for Best Male Country Vocal of the Year. So here is Charlie Rich and Behind Closed Doors. We'll see you next week.
How are you?